Father, as we gather here today, it's been quite a week here with the snowstorms and life and stuff, and sometimes we forget about you. We lose sight of you. As a result, we end up doing things in our own strength, and that doesn't really go so well. This morning, as we get together here, we just want to remember that you're real. And you want to play a real role in our lives, not just on Sundays, but in every day of the week. You want to walk with us. You want to enjoy us in everything we go through. And you want us to enjoy you. And so, Father, even as we meet today, would you remind us of that? And would you help us to make you the priority focus of our life? Even as we leave this building, may we remember you're walking with us. And you want to lead us and guide us and strengthen us and bless our lives and direct us. And so, Father, even as Russell speaks today, would you empower him? He's just going to speak his simple words that he can share, but we ask that your Holy Spirit would take those words and put a spiritual punch behind them that we could never achieve. And Lord, as Evangelos and Shelley lead in worship and Cliff on drums, Lord, would you just draw us into a worship time of just celebrating you? We pray for our kids' ministries as they meet. Bless them. May they find an excitement about Jesus as they gather together. And Lord, for our Honduras ministries, Gordon Anna and Manos Extendidas and Compassion Churches, Lord, would you bless our Honduras outreach partners? Would you give them an exciting time with you today? So, Father, thanks that we can meet together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Wow, a lot of people showed up. You guys are all here to see me? I even dressed up. You can thank that much of my wife there. She dresses me. But then I hear God telling me, no, 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 no. You guys aren't here to see me. You're here to hear me through me. So you guys want to hear God's words through me. That's a lot of pressure. I don't know how if I can handle it. If I can't handle that pressure, it's just like, what if I say something wrong? If I say something wrong, then Cliff might not show up anymore. And it's just, what's going to happen? It just makes me really, really nervous because that's a lot to live up to. And that means that I kind of have to be careful how I walk. And what does that mean? That means I have to be careful what I do and what I say and everything like that. And it's just really nerve-wracking. So I remember walking through the hallways of a school and stuff, and I used to walk in a certain way, and it wasn't the way I was walking with God. But then I started to read. It's like, well, I opened up my Bible, and I opened up the King James Version, and I went to see that you walk circumspectly. Well, I didn't even know what that was, first of all. And it says, not as wise, not as fools, but as wise. It's like, walk. And wise, well, I got that down pat. Now I can do that, not a problem. And I always point to people when I walk down the hall. I didn't know who you were, but they all have theme music. But then God said, no, 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 no. And you guys think I'm joking. I did walk down the halls like that, so. I really did. But God says, no, 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 Russ. Be careful how you represent me. It's not about the walk. It's about how you represent me. Can you bring my highs down, please? I'm starting to peak. Thank you. It's how you represent me. The Lord, thank you. It's how you represent me. And then I start to read other things. So I start to read the Ephesians in the Living Translation, which basically says, be careful how you live. Don't act like fools, but act like those who are wise. And I was like, oh, okay, I'm starting to get it now. So it's really important not just to take a Bible verse and take it out of context. You're supposed to be able to move it around and understand the whole context of it. So one time, I used to work in a construction place. My brother was helping renovating the house. And so, technical difficulties. my voice isn't usually that high. So one time I was working in a construction place, and as a lot of people know, some construction workers, they sometimes have potty mouths. And so after a while, I was helping my brother just recently work on this house on Rodney Street. And I came there, and there's a bunch of construction workers there. So what I did automatically was I just fell back into my old ways, and I started to swear. And my brother was there, and he stopped me in my tracks. He said, "What are you doing? That's not you anymore. What are you doing swearing? That's just not you." And I had to think about that. And what was I was not, at that point, I was not representing Christ in that moment. I was not, you guys sit down, by the way.
What was that?
Yep.
We can sit down.
Yep.
Okay. Sorry.
I'm going to talk for a couple minutes. I wasn't representing Christ, and I was giving him a false image of what Christ is and who he is. Because I had two opportunities. And every day that you have an opportunity, you have two choices. You can represent the old you before Christ or the new you, the one that has Christ in your life. And we have that choice every single day. And I blew it at that moment. And my brother knew it. So seize those moments when you have those opportunities. And because people are watching. People are watching you and the things that you do. And one of the biggest things that atheists always say is like, "I seen that guy. He's supposed to be following Christ, and he's not following Christ. As soon as Sunday's over, they're out doing this and doing that." And that's one of the main excuses that they use to not understand who Christ actually is. So be careful who you represent. And at that moment, I wasn't representing them very nicely. I've been blessed with a job where I do care work. So right out of high school, I used to take care of people physically, mentally challenged. And I never really thought much of it, but I used to take care of them, and it was really, really easy. I would just go to their house, I would cook, I'd clean, I'd just hang out with them, I'd take them to movies and all that stuff. So I did that from high school. I got out of it, didn't think that was really important work. And then God put me back into it just recently. So now I'm doing a full-time position over at Withrod, which is basically taking care of three ladies. And it's a wonderful experience that I can actually have impact. And we actually take those opportunities to pray with them and to show them who Christ is, which is a big difference to how I used to be. So in that position, there was something happened at work where there in the work that I have, it's just basically a household setting, but there's a video camera that's up in the top corner. Now, most of the time, you forget that the camera's even there, but one time there's something happened, and then so I had to go with my supervisor and watch the tape. And so we were kind of watching, and it was great weird. I don't know if you guys ever watch yourself on tape, but it's just like, man, it's like, I know I never did nothing wrong, but I'm sitting there nervous as anything. It's like, did I say everything I was supposed to? I didn't say anything I did wasn't supposed to say or anything like that. It was really kind of nerve-wracking to have something watch me, which kind of got me thinking, it's like, how's God see the pictures of you have you go through your daily life, which is kind of weird, right? To have something that you can play that back. And I thought about it, it's like, you know, how do other people, if they look into my life, how are they going to see who Christ is through just the last week? And I thought about it for myself, what picture of Christ am I painting for people who are unbelievers? And if somebody, and just maybe even look at your guys' last week. If there was somebody who didn't know anything about Christ and they just watched you for 1 week, what picture would they have of Christ through you? I want you to think about that as the worship team comes up. Just when the Holy Spirit just kind of takes over you, and just, I don't know, I love those songs. And of course, you guys play my favorite ones too. It's every single time. I just love it. And I must say that when I was a kid, I always wanted to have my own theme song. And I think I'm starting to get one, actually. So this is pretty good. I love it. So never thought I would actually get my own theme song. So it was great. Representing Christ. When Rob asked me to speak, he said, pick anything or the Bible and speak on it.
And I said, oh, geez, okay. That's not an easy task or anything. So, of course, I want to do what I want to speak on. And I said, yeah, that'd be kind of a great motivational thing. Let's do one about money, or let's do one about, you know, whatever. But really, it took me a long time to come up with this, but it's really the Holy Spirit led me to how are you representing me. It's really the core of where I was led through this sermon. And to give you guys a little bit of background, I have an Aunt Shelley, who couldn't be here today, but I did speak with her last night. She was really the first representative of Christ that I've ever experienced in my life. Actually, sorry, the second. The first one was my grandfather. My grandfather would sit at the dining room table, fold his hands, and pray. No apologies. And I so respected that. And I'd never seen anybody else do it. Anytime that anyone else in their family, we would pray. It was kind of, is anyone watching? And then we'd pray. My grandfather? Nope. Pop right up. And I'm praying to the Lord. So that was my first picture of model of someone representing Christ, no matter what. No matter who's looking, didn't care who was watching, he just did it. My aunt, Sherry, she's very spiritual, but when I talked to her, she said that she was very religious at the time. So she would go to church. She would always have a Bible verse on hand if someone was going through something. And be honest, most of the family was kind of annoyed with it. Because every time if we had a problem, she was like, okay, well, in Ephesians 1, and we're like, oh, we're not talking about that. We're talking about real life stuff. Stop looking at that book, and we're dealing with this situation. So anyways, years went by of her really doing the religion part, but not having a relationship. She was driving up with Aunt Sherry and Aunt Shelley. My two aunts, who I very much respected. I was probably about 11 years old, maybe 12 years old. And they were driving up the highway. And on the highway, they had the medium, the cement medium. And they were in the lane closest to the medium. And there was a dump truck that was traveling beside them. And the dump truck decides to change lanes and squishes them in between the medium. The car was absolutely total. If you looked at the car, there'd be no way that anybody, it literally was like down that low. The truck driver gets out of the car, runs over to save my Aunt Shelley, and pulls her out. My Aunt Shelley suffers burns on her arm. Then as he got her out, the whole car engulfs in flames. When he reached through, he couldn't get her out. And he had to drag her out of the flames, over across the flames. She was burnt from head to toe. She lost several fingers. Complete face burnt. I couldn't recognize her. That was really hard. When you have someone that's following the Bible in the religious sense and something horrible like that happens to them, where they're burnt head to toe, what do you do with that? What do you do with that when someone that you love goes through something and one of the people who was representing who Christ was, and then they go through something like that? So as she was got out, really the family got angry, including myself. Why didn't he look in his blind spot before he went and turned that lane? How could he do that to my aunt? And a lot of people wanted revenge. We wanted to sue him. Just, let's get revenge on this guy. Like it somehow it's going to matter to her after she's burnt. But my aunt didn't want no part of it. She didn't want nothing to do with that at all. All she wanted to do was forgive. And that was one of the first moments that I seen Christ shine through somebody. And it impacted me for the rest of my life. At that time, even as a little boy, I knew that there was something greater than myself that was out there. Something, I didn't know I knew of God, I didn't know who God was. But it was the first time that I actually get to see God here. And she came to Natal Day. Was the one of the first times that she was able to get out. This was months of doing surgery after surgery after surgery. And I seen her, and she came to Natal Day. And we always had a traditional spot at the Wise family. Always sat on one specific corner at Natal Day. And it was always one spot. And she was there. And I was scared to look at her. She had a mask on. It was like a brown fabric mask with just all you could see is her eyes. And that was just to hold her skin in place after all the surgeries that she had. And I looked down at her hands, and her hands, fingers were missing. And that just freaked me out as a little kid. But then I looked in her eyes, and I seen a shine. I seen Christ coming out, like she was still glowing, happy and glorious to be alive. She didn't focus on the fact that she's burnt head to toe. She was focused on that, how could she survive? Why did God save her from a car that was crushed down to the ground? Why was she still here? That was her focus. And I talked to her last night, and this is the first time I talked to her last night about it, about the accident. Which, when you start doing these sermon stuff, it makes you, brings you outside your comfort zone when you walk with Jesus. So I never talked to my aunt about this at all, to get her perspective. And that's what it was, is that she was mostly focused on God saved her for a reason. And at the time, she thought that she was supposed to be, she started a burn group for burn survivors. And she thought that's what her calling was, to help people through those trying times and help them through that. Then she realized she was doing good in that, but then she went to a ladies' retreat, of all things. What a coincidence. She went to a ladies' retreat and found that what her salvation was based on. And she said that she was doing all the things right so she could go to heaven. And then her friend of hers was saying, I can't go to heaven because I'm doing all the things wrong. And she's telling me, well, neither one of us going on that criteria. It's just like, it's not about all the things that you're doing and not all the things that you can't do. It's about salvation and grace. And she basically just went through and found Jesus that weekend. She found that she could have a relationship with Jesus. And she came home and her husband said, what happened to you? You're changed. There's something changed about you. And from that point, she was all about glorifying God. And that's what she continues to do today, is to glorify God. And that was my first picture of how we can live Christ within us. It was my first picture of how to actually be God's representative. Because we have a choice every single day. We could choose to go down a path of the situation, I'll just do this, go to my old ways, or step into the new life that I'm supposed to step into, what is the life that Christ wants me to live. And this is the way that Christ wants me to walk. So do we choose to represent him or not? That is the choice. And we have that choice every single day. Every single moment we have that choice. And like the construction workers that I was talking to you about before, I blew it at that moment. I gave him a false picture of what Christ wants me to be, which hopefully that doesn't hinder him from getting to know Christ himself. And when I talked to my aunt, she was totally oblivious of the impact that she had on me. She was just going about her day, doing the best that she could to represent Christ, not realizing how many people that she was affecting, how many people she was giving the light to along the way. And I was one of them. And I was one of the ones that was a big benefactor of knowing her and being around her and seeing Christ shine through her. So the other part about it is when you embrace Jesus like that, you're going to have two types of reactions. You're going to get the people who love it, and you're going to get the people who hate it. And even in my family, every time my aunt would bring out a Bible verse, there's some people that would sit there, I don't understand, every time I have an issue, you bring up the Bible. My friend of mine's like, he's going through a problem with his relationship. I said, you know, we learn that stuff in church. He always changes the subject. I'm not giving up, though. Because this is the answer. And so often, there's people just like who want to sue the truck driver. They want that revenge. And again, I respected my aunt so much because she didn't do that. And she, in between, I guess they met one time, and she face to face forgave him. And that is so powerful. So powerful that somebody could, she had every opportunity to hate God. Why wouldn't she? In everyone else's eyes. But she didn't. And I respect her for that. In Ephesians, the good news is that in the Ephesians, it kind of gives you the kind of cold notes of the Bible, which is kind of how to do this. So in Ephesians 5:15-20, it says, be careful how you live. Don't act like fools, but be like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. Don't get drunk in wine, because it will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, making music to the Lord with your hearts. And give thanks to everything, to God, the Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That whole thing, when you break that down and understand the whole context of it, and not take something out of context like I was doing earlier, thinking just because I see my name, I was like, okay, I got that, or not understanding a certain word and just leaving it at that. If you don't understand something, there's other things to go about. There's a flow chart to this, really. One of it, of this passage, is to be careful. Be careful how you walk every day that you have a situation. You can represent God or you don't, or you represent your old self. There's an opportunity to do that. But you need to know who He is to know what the opportunities are. If you don't know what He wants from you, then how are you going to know how to represent Him? And then once you do that, you let the Holy Spirit come into your life and guide you. And once you do that, then you, again, come up back to the circle and be careful, once again, of how you're walking. But now you have the Holy Spirit who is guiding you, who is within you, and will guide you in the right way for the walks that you need to walk. So again, you break that down on the be careful. On the lines there, it says the days, there's a reason why he says be careful, don't act like fools, and the days are evil. Because not only does God know who you are, the evil one knows what your weaknesses are. He knows when you are at your weakest, and that's when he will present the opportunity for you to go down the wrong path. And he will just line it up like a bunch, like a floodlight. But that's not the way. Those lights are dim. The bright light is way over here on the side. You just follow Jesus in that way. And there's a reason that he says, watch your steps, throughout the whole Bible. And the evil one came to Jesus when he was starving in the wilderness. Right? When Jesus was at his weakest, that's when he came and presented himself, because he knew Jesus was weak. But Jesus didn't fall for him. He didn't fall for all his tricks and games and stuff like that, which is the same games that he's playing on you today. He's not going to be able to present to you what you're weak at when he knows that you're down. When you're depressed, the things that you struggle with, that's what he'll bring up to you. Don't fall for it. Don't fall for it, because Jesus and the Lord are are powerful and they're within you. So take the opportunity. Take the opportunity in every situation. It's just the little things, guys. It's the little things that we do as we go through our day. Some people, when I first started phase one, we were like, well, I need the opportunity to talk to somebody. And we would go week after week. And every week that we would talk, it's like, did anyone have a God opportunity this week? It's like, well, no. I could have talked to this one guy, but I didn't bother talking to him. And week after week, and it wasn't until about phase three that I actually started getting it. And started realizing that there's opportunity every personal reaction, every personal time I talk to somebody, that's an opportunity to represent Christ. And there's one time I was on the bus. This was just last week. And I was, I tried to be productive, so Cliff, you appreciate this. I broke up my music notes and I was just kind of drumming on my legs there, trying to get a beat down, right? So I had my music notes and I was trying to follow along. And this guy behind me comes up and says, you must play in a worship band. No, not at all. But I'm not quite there yet. I'm just, you know, messing around with it. And so anyways, we had this great God conversation. We started talking about the church plan. And we started talking about all this stuff. And I was like, where did this spawn from? Jesus will give you opportunities as long as you see it. So anyways, I wasn't even paying attention. At the end of the conversation, I invited him out to church and everything. It was great. On my notes, on the big title, it says, Jesus Saves. So I'm like, oh, that's why the conversation comes. I was totally oblivious to it, right? So Jesus will open up doors to you if you're representing him. And the doors were wide open. And the other part about it is, like, people always ask you, well, how did you make that flow? And it's just like, well, how did you get into that conversation? Well, I was oblivious at the time of it. We just started chatting, and then it was all about God and realizing that, you know, the big old title on my thing, Jesus Saved. So I thought that was kind of neat. But, and again, we have the opportunities every day. I watched, in my bathroom, there's always these little sayings there. It says, be the change that you want to see. If you think about that, it's like, stop complaining all the time, but make the little steps that you can to make a difference. Whether it's caring for someone, opening a door for somebody, giving a loving hand. It makes a huge difference. It really does. But do it with the right heart. There's a reason why Jesus says in here, he says, do it with the right heart. And he's always talking about a heart issue all the time. Because it's not about the things that you do. Melissa and I were watching a movie, I think it was called The Cardboard Boxer. And in that movie, there's a homeless person that was sitting down, and a missionary came over and was praying with him in the scene. And at the end of prayer, he goes, welcome to God's kingdom. And he got up. And now, mind you, the homeless person didn't say a word. So he didn't actually ask God for anything. The person just prayed to him, not with him. And believe me, that's a big difference between praying with somebody and praying to somebody. But anyways, the person got up and he said, he was just about to leave, and the homeless person's like, well, tell me more about this. I don't understand. Tell me more. And the person's like, no, I got to go over here and pray with this person. I got to go pray to this person. And he walked away. And all that person really wanted to know who Jesus really was and take the time, invest your time into someone who really is craving Jesus. And that person blew it because there was an opportunity right there. So there's opportunities all around us. And the next part of it is really, you got to know to see the opportunities, you got to know him. You really got to be reading. And not only just reading, but I'm trying to understand. When I first started, even in phase one, I read it, but not to the extent of, I want to understand what that word is. I'm not going to go look that text and see and read a different version and say, well, how does that fit in the context and stuff? Until I actually started, Rob's like, okay, well, why don't you start speaking now? It's like, okay. So to understand it fully before I talk to anybody about it. And it's one thing to learn it, it's another thing to teach it. So get to the point that you can share it with others. But the other part about it is Read one thing, share. Read, share. Is really the way that it goes. But not only reading, throughout, it says, be in community. Sing amongst yourselves, right? So basically, come together in community. If you guys aren't in a community group, I totally recommend it. It's a chance for us to share, support each other, to grow, to learn, and more importantly, know who Jesus is and how to be your representatives. And we are stronger together. I repeat that. We are stronger together. So many times throughout my walk, when I was down and out, there was somebody from LifeBridge that would reach out a helping hand, that gave me a hug, that gave me encouragement, that even sometimes bought me groceries when we had nothing. That stuff is so powerful for our walks. And I thank you. I thank all of you. Because I credit you guys for my walk, really do. And it's just wonderful that people are here to do that. So once you know him, then you allow the Holy Spirit to come and be filled by the Holy Spirit. And there's one time a friend of mine was being baptized. And he got down and asked Jesus to come into his life. And he's praying. And then after his prayer, he looked up like something was going to happen right away. And he was scared that, you know, the lightning bolts, and he was going to be able to use his spidey senses and all this stuff. But it was really interesting to allow the Spirit to come through him. And it's a guidance that you have with the Holy Spirit that's like no other. And once you recognize that he's there, then he's here to help you. And then we're here to help you. And together, we'll grow in our walk with Christ. It says in Ephesians 5:18 that be filled with the Holy Spirit, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, and making music of the Lord in your hearts. And give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you go back to it, he doesn't say sing spiritual songs by yourself. He doesn't say do it by yourself. He says to do it amongst each other and in community. Build each other up. And connect with each other. If we're all connected and growing into the body of Christ, and there's always references to the body of Christ that, you know, this finger is doing this, and this hand's doing this, and this foot's doing this. We're all the body of Christ so that we can actually walk with him. We all have our own strengths, and we all have our own weaknesses. But as one body, we can do anything. And it's pretty amazing for us to be able to do that. And we need to build each other up. I think it was in mostly phase two, I started doing a grateful list. So in the morning, what I used to do is list off all the things I was grateful for. So if I wake up that night, if I had an argument or whatever, and I was just really mad at the world, I would say, God, I'm grateful for breathing. I'm grateful that you have me here. In my aunt's case, she's grateful to be alive. Grateful to have impact on you. She might be burnt head to toe, but she's still grateful. I totally respect for that. And if you do that list, no matter how bad of an argument you might have with your wife or your spouse, it's really hard to be mad at them after you start listing off all the things you love them for. It's like, I love my wife for being there for me. I love my wife for being the mother of my children. It just puts you in a different perspective, and it makes things kind of come together and to be grateful. And then you walk around with a whole new attitude when you start doing that as well. So I encourage you guys to make your grateful list. And it could be anything. It could be that you have shoes on your feet. Growing up, when I was a kid, some of you know I had a tough background. Parents were alcoholics. Used to have parties at my house all the time. And, You know, just really bad stuff. But what always kind of got to me is like, you know what? It could be worse. So somebody out there that is suffering 10 times more, and how can I reach out to them? And what do I have that I'm grateful for? And one of that at the time was, I'm grateful for to have a roof. I'm grateful that I have brothers and sisters who love me, that would do anything for me. I'm grateful for that I don't, at the time, I don't know who God is, but I know He's out there. And I know He has greater things for me to do. So when my friends are doing things and they're stealing jackets and beating people up, I know I have a greater purpose to make the choice to represent Him or go down the old me and to represent that. And we have that choice every day, and it goes back to the very small things. So when you guys play back the video of your week, take a look at how you represent Him this week. And challenge yourself on the very little things to do things, like pray for somebody. Do you know how powerful that is? It is extremely powerful to sit down and pray for somebody. And not just for them, with them. You pray with somebody, it's amazing the results that you can have. And love somebody. Take yourself away from self and reach out and love somebody. And give of your time. Give of your time. You'd be amazing with the results that God's going to have for you in His walk. Seize the opportunity as this week as we represent. Because in the smallest ways, it's the greatest things in His eyes. So I'm going to close in prayer. Thank You, Heavenly Father, for this group in LifeBridge, that we can come here as a community and support each other and love each other. Please say that throughout the rest of the week, that we'd be able to remember that You are here right beside us as we walk with You. And as we come along and see opportunity, seize that we'd be able to seize that opportunity so that we can speak Christ into their lives. Thank You so much for everything that You do. Please say that I can be Your representative. Please say that I'd be able to shine the light onto others and have a different perspective on life. In Jesus' name, amen.